We have already seen a couple of normed spaces as examples. Here is another set of examples which consists of spaces of functions. Let us start with a space of continuous functions. We have already seen that a space of continuous functions is a vector space, and now we want to see how we can make it into a normed vector space. So consider let T be a metric space, or in general you could also consider a topological space if you wanted, but in this lecture we always assume we are in a metric space. So this is the space on which our functions are defined, and then we consider the space CB of T of bounded functions that are defined on this space. So this is the set of all functions that go from T to R, where F is continuous and bounded. And note that to define whether a function is continuous or not, we need to have a topology, or in our case, a metric. So this is a simple space of functions, and now we want to make it into a normed space. So we need to define a norm on the space and then check whether it has the properties that we would like to have. So as norm on the space, sometimes I write the space with a curly C and sometimes with a non-curly C. As a norm on the space of bounded functions on T, we now use the supremum's norm, and this norm is defined as the norm denoted by infinity, f infinity of a function, is the supremum over all elements in our space of the absolute value that the function takes. So this is the largest value, if you want, that a function takes, if this supremum exists. It does exist in this case because we're in a space of bounded functions, so by definition, all functions are bounded from above, so maybe I should write this explicitly, just to make sure everybody knows what I mean by bounded. By bounded, I mean there exists a constant in R such that the absolute value of f of t is smaller than c for all t in t. This means the function is bounded, and by this definition, this supremum norm here is always well defined. There doesn't exist, so in our space of functions, there's not a function where the supremum wouldn't exist. Okay, and now the way I've used the word already is I said this is a norm, and now we need to check whether this really is a norm, and then we need to check, and then my next statement is that the space of continuous functions together with this norm is a Banach space. I write it down. Then the space C infinity, C bounded of T with the norm infinity is in fact a Banach space. So what are now all the things we would need to prove? I'm not going to do it in detail, I just give you the outline of what you need to do. First of all, you need to prove that this is a vector space. So if you take two functions, you sum them, the result is again a continuous bounded function. If you do the same with a scalar multiplication. So you can check all these axioms that you have to check for a vector space, and they are true, that's easy to see. Then you need to prove that this norm is in fact really a norm. This is also not very difficult. You need to prove all these quantities that you have, these couple of axioms for a norm. And then now the statement is not only it's a normed space, but also it's a Banach space, and this means it's complete. And the space being complete means if I have a sequence of functions, and the sequence of functions converges in the norm that we are currently considering, say, so in this case the infinity norm, then the limiting object, the limiting function exists and is an element of the space as well. Now here this is clear because the infinity norm induces uniform convergence, and it's well known, hopefully, from analysis that if you have a sequence of functions, of continuous functions, and the sequence converges uniformly, then the limiting function is also a continuous function. So what you can see then is if you have a sequence of continuous functions converging according to your norm, the limiting object is also continuous, and it's really easy to see that the limiting object is also a bounded function, And then you have that the limiting function lives in the same space as the sequence, and so your space is complete. So this is how the proof goes. Maybe I just write the outline. We need to check the vector space axioms. We need to check the norm axioms. And all these things are really easy. And then we need to check the completeness. And this follows because we have uniform convergence. Maybe I write this just as a keyword, follows from the fact that the infinity norm induces what we in standard analysis would call uniform convergence. And intuitively, uniform convergence means that at all places, like for all t, the sequences of the function values ft converge with the same speed to the underlying function. So this is what we typically call uniform convergence. But if you don't know that anymore, you might want to look it up. Okay. So this was a space of continuous functions. Maybe I write this space of continuous functions as a little headline, space of continuous functions. And you can also look at different ways to define spaces of continuous functions. You might not want to look at bounded functions, but maybe at functions that decay and finally fade out to zero or something like that. So many variations of these spaces of continuous functions. But typically the norm we use in functional analysis, if we deal with continuous functions, is the infinity norm, the norm we have defined here. Now, the other functions we are really interested in analysis is differentiable functions. Now, how can we define spaces of differentiable functions? And in particular, how can we assign a norm that makes sense in these spaces? So, and again, I just want to give you one example, a space of differentiable functions. Now, as our underlying space, we now simply consider the functions that are once continuously differentiable on some real-valued interval, just for to make it concrete. So let A, B be an interval in R, and consider the space C1 on A, B, which is the space of functions that are continuously differentiable. So these are the functions that go from A, B to R, and f needs to be is continuously differentiable. Okay. And now the question is which norm we might want to define. So this is a vector space. I think we have already seen this example before. It's easy to see. So if you add two functions that are continuously differentiable, the sum is also continuously differentiable, and the same goes for scalar multiplication. So that's easy, you can satisfy all the axioms. But the question is now, which norm do we want to add? So which norm? And the first candidate you might want to come up with is again the infinity norm. So we could say we consider the infinity norm on this space. But now the problem is that under this norm, the space is not going to be complete. Because you can construct sequences of functions that converge uniformly, and all these functions are differentiable, but the limiting object is not a differentiable function, and then it's not in the space. So maybe I write it in this way. I write it a bit differently. So the first choice is consider the infinity norm. And my statement is, with this norm, the space is not going to be complete. With this norm, the space of C1 functions is not complete. And the counterexample, I guess most of you would be able to construct such a counterexample. So you need to construct a sequence of functions which is continuously differentiable, but the limiting object is not differentiable. And you could, for example, consider functions. Let me just make an example. So this is my coordinate system. And I make maybe a plot like this. So this is going to be my limiting function, which is not, so the limit function. And this, you can see that it's not differentiable, at least that's what I want to imply with this drawing. So there it has, it's not smooth, and there's a corner in this function, so we can't define the derivative at this particular point, because we can't decide should it go in this way or this way. So here it's not defined. And now I want to construct a sequence of functions that converges to this, to uniformly to this, and you can do something. I just want to draw the figure, I don't even want to give you the formula. So here you have a function, it looks a bit like a parabola maybe, that's maybe f1, and then you construct another function f2, maybe I make it dashed, which is below that. So this is f2 and so on. So you keep on constructing functions that approximate these blue functions more and more closely. You can always keep these green functions being differentiable, nice and smooth. But the limit, you can already see it from the figure, but you can, the distance between the green and the blue function goes to zero uniformly. So you can always find something like an epsilon tube around the blue function such that the green function is completely contained. And you can make this epsilon tube as small as you want. So you have uniform convergence. And all these green functions are in C1, but the limiting function, the blue function, is not in C1. So this is an example which shows that if you just use the infinitron, it induces, of course, a notion of convergence, but it doesn't make the space complete. And from a mathematical point of view, that's always really inconvenient if you have a space and your limiting objects are not in that space, then all of functional analysis becomes much more complicated, and we don't want it. So the question is, can we define better norms on the spaces of continuous functions, of differentiable functions? And the answer is yes. There are many many you can do, but I just want to mention two obvious. I write two norms. Maybe I write the first norm, norm of F, which is the supremum, T in AB. And now, but we want to have a supremum over two things. The norm of the function, the absolute value of the function, and the absolute value of the derivative of the function. I write it down, a maximum of the norm of the absolute value of T and the absolute value of F prime of T, the derivative. This is one norm I want to consider. And the other norm you might want to consider is, maybe I write it with three lines just to make sure it's a different one. The norm with three lines I define as the sum of the infinity norm of F plus the infinity norm of F prime. And now what is, it's reasonably easy to see that these two norms do induce completeness. And so if we have C1 with any of these two norms, then it is a Banach space. So I write C1 of AB with any of these two norms, two norms, is a Banach space. And I would like to invite you to try to really prove that as an exercise. The only interesting thing to prove here is the completeness, and you might want to start looking at the example we had before, the one with this blue curve that has a corner, and try to see why the counterexample that we constructed here is not going to be a counterexample anymore if we have these other kinds of norms. And I mean, the obvious thing is that we now also take into account the derivative, so maybe just try to work out what you think would be a good estimate of the derivatives of these functions close to zero, and then you're going, or close to this corner, and then you're going to see why this counterexample is going to fail, and this maybe helps you also to understand why in general that whole thing is going to lead to a complete vector space, a complete normed vector space or Banach space. Okay. So now we have seen spaces of continuous functions, we have seen spaces of differentiable functions, and the next obvious chapter is spaces of integrable functions. And I want to devote a complete new lecture to this because constructing spaces of integrable functions, I mean, that's something that's really important also for machine learning. And I really want you to understand what LP spaces are, so I'm going to do that step by step in the next lecture.